Welcome to online worship at Centenary United Methodist Church. We're glad you...
Everybody, please rise for the presentation of the college. Color guard, attention. Color guard, forward march. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Two. Carter, four. Carter. Forward march. Color guard, hold. Color guard, dismiss. Everybody be united.
Thank you. Good morning. Welcome to Centenary United Methodist Church. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, it's so good to see you this morning. Welcome to those who are watching us online and to those who are listening to us on 97.9 The Bear. It is good to be with you all this morning. Let's start our service off by silencing our cell phones. Note that there is a response card in each pew where you can fill out a card for a prayer request or for information about the church and put it in the offering plates later in the service. And there will be a Stephen minister down front to pray with you at the conclusion of the service if you want that. Lent began officially on Ash Wednesday, and we had our first Lenten luncheon. Those luncheons and services will continue every Wednesday throughout the season of Lent, all the way through Holy Week. So the next one is this coming Wednesday at noon. Our own Pastor Michael will be the speaker, and there will be lunch served. I think the Missions Committee is actually responsible for it this time. So please show up, and let's worship Christ together every Wednesday for Lent. The Lenten Bible study Pastor Susan is leading will meet tomorrow at 1:30. She asked me to remind those of you who signed up, please read the first chapter before you come so you know what's going on. There's an insert in your bulletin. It has a couple of things on it. One of those two things is from the Creation Care Committee asking you to consider one of these or some other thing, helping out God's creation as a way of a Lenten pledge, and they're interested in getting feedback from you on what that might be. The other side talks about our Lenten offering for this Lenten season, and it is the first of our monthly mission moments. And for that, I'm going to invite Patty Peebles to come up and share with us.
Did you know that women incarceration has grown at twice the pace of men's in the last two decades since the turn of the century? Once released, more women are more likely than men to face the issues of homelessness and face barriers to employment as well as housing, permanent housing. The situation often leads, unfortunately, then to women needing in their minds to return to crime in order to try to meet those basic needs, which begins the cycle of rearrest and imprisonment. Sadly, 75% of incarcerated women, post-incarcerated women, will return to prison within 5 years. Tried by Fire is a faith-based ministry here in a nonprofit organization here in Newburgh, committed to helping those post-incarcerated women find hope and healing during that tough transitional time. Tried by Fire is my sister's house, will provide temporary shelter, 90 to 120 days, for up to 8 women at one time in a monitored, supportive environment after they're released from prison. A personal plan, transition plan is put together, and referrals arranged, and there's a lot of existing opportunities and programs in the community to help them get on the road and rebuild their lives towards a positive and productive future. Now, many of you may know the background of my sister's house. In 2019, Tried by Fire Executive Director Benita Simmons saw this problem and, unlike many of us, decided to try to do something about the problem. An existing home, and so with that, she formed Tried by Fire and began this effort to build my sister's house. An existing home requiring major extensive renovations was acquired, and funds were raised, and in September of 20, I think it was, no, October of 2020, renovations began. Unfortunately, by September of 2021, the realization came that this house was not, the renovations was just too extensive, it was too much of a project, and thus the decision was made to extend themselves out and build, take down that house and rebuild and put a brand new 4-bedroom, 4-bath home into my sister's house. Obviously there was a lot more money was needed to get there. Now if you've been following this project, you'll know that they're nearing the end. And recently they were granted a $45,000 grant from the Anonymous Trust out of Raleigh. In order to get those funds, they need $5,000 from donors never having given to my sister's house Tried by Fire before. And that's where we can come in. We will take up our Lenten offering, and I think it would be really cool if we could somehow be the major part of that $5,000 that they need in order to get the $45,000 from Anonymous Trust. So that's where the Lenten offering is going. Psalm 147:3. He heals the brokenhearted and builds up their wounds. And when I think about that, I think Tried by Fire, my sister's house, is the work of God. There's a flyer and a bullet. Thank you for your time. Appreciate all your assistance.
Patty, thank you for sharing that with us. Let's quickly go through the rest of our announcements. If you are a graduating high school senior, or if you have one in your family, the scholarship applications that Centenary offers for graduates are in envelopes, and the church office combined will get you one. Hymns and Hops will meet at 2:00 today at the Brown Pelican. We continue to look for someone to do the responsibilities of the church sexton position. To do the cleaning, minor maintenance. We've had some folks come in and give us estimates. If you know of someone that you recommend, an individual or a couple or a company, please let us know. We'll get in touch with them and have them come in so we can get an estimate. The 250th anniversary DVD is now available, and it is in locations around the church. It's in the narthex out in front of the chapel. It is in the office. It is in the lobby outside the office in front of the history room. They are free. They are for everyone. This is not the same as the video for the celebration at the History Center. This has clips from all of the different services and events that we did during the entirety of 2022. And so I hope you'll be able to pick up one of those as a way of remembering what a wonderful year that it was. One last thing, and that is in the bulletin, there is a slight typo, and that is there is no revival tomorrow or tonight. I think it says revival 7:00. As much as we would like to do another one this week, we're not ready for that yet. Now, if you show up and a revival starts, please call me and I'll be here. Meanwhile, we hope that we can plan one for the fall. I'm not going to promise it, but I would say that we'll pray about it and see what we can pull together. It was a wonderful week. Your bulletin has lots of opportunities for learning and serving. Please make sure you read all of those and take them to heart this week. May your awareness of God deepen during this week, and may God's love strengthen you for all that you do. And with that note, I'm going to ask Tim to come up now and give us a report on our scouting ministry. So Tim, if you'll come up and bring us up to date.
Centenary United Methodist Church has been gracious enough to be involved in scouting for many, many years, starting with the Boy Scout Troop 13 in 1929. So our troop is 94 years old this year. With that being said, the Scout Hall, most of you know it as the old basement, we call it the Scout Hall, is utilized four nights a week for scouting, either Cub Scouts, Girl Scouts, Boy Scouts, or Brownies. But we have a long, long livelihood of scouting, and Centenary has done so much to support it. And with that, we do not want it to change. We want it to go on for 100 years and more. But in the 94 years, Centenary has only had 11 Scoutmasters. So when each Scoutmaster gets in, serve a long term, whether it's by choice or not. Yeah. So with that being said, I would like any Scoutmasters, former or now, please stand in the room and show that you served. It doesn't matter whether it's Troop 13 or any other troop. If you're a former Scoutmaster, please stand. Thank you, Bob. Keep standing, please. Yep, Bob Taylor, y'all, one of our former Scoutmasters. Any Girl Scout leaders in the past, please stand. Girl Scout leaders here or other places, please. Any Boy Scout leaders and Cub Scout leaders, please stand. And all of you keep standing. Any ladies or gentlemen that were Scouts as a youth, please stand. Anybody that had a family member or any association for scouting, can you please stand? And as you can see, almost 100% of our congregation is standing.
Yeah.
And so scouting reaches far and wide. Y'all can be seated. But it reaches far and wide. It is a tremendous youth ministry. It takes young men and young women and turns them into leaders of today. It builds a stepping path for them to become great men and women. And as all of y'all stood up, we know that. Y'all walked that path. And I thank you for that. One last thing I want to do, because they always deserve recognition. If you are a former, or you still are, I guess it's not a former, you always are. If you're an Eagle Scout in the room, please stand. Anytime anyone wants to visit our Scout meetings, we meet at
you stand if you're able and join me in the opening prayer in your bulletin? Let us pray. Holy One, we are constantly bombarded with temptations and enticements. When we yield, when we fail, who will help us? You, Lord, have come to our aid. You teach us, counsel us, and guide us in the ways we should go. We rejoice in your unfailing love. Amen. The hymn is number 158. Come, Christians, join to sing. 158. May be seated. I invite any children who are here today, our youngest saints, if you would come down to the front now for our children's time. Come on down.
You guys. flap your wings like a chicken. Simon says, jump up and down. Quack like a duck. Ah! You're doing great! Okay, Simon says, the game's over, come sit down. Wonderful job. You guys did so good. So Simon Says is a fun game that we all play as children and adults. And do we have a Simon in our daily lives that kind of tell us what we should be doing? We don't play Simon Says all the time, do we? That'd be weird. What do we have? Yeah, we have Children's Church, yeah. And so in Children's Church, is a good answer. In Children's Church, we talk a lot about God and we read the
prayer.
Read the Bible, right? And that's kind of our Simon Says, right? We've got the Word of God written for us, very convenient in a book that we can read anytime we want. And so that is what we look for guidance. And in today's lesson, when we go to our room, we're going to learn about a time that Jesus was tempted by the devil. And the devil was trying to trick Jesus, but Jesus knew better because he knew what the Bible said. And so we're going to go say that. Sounds good? Duncan has something he needs to say.
Look out!
Okay. Very good. All right, let's bow our heads and say our prayer. Dear God, help us to do what Jesus did. Help us to do what the Bible tells us to do instead of listening to what the devil would have us do. In God's name, amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. Let's join together now in the prayer for illumination in your bulletin. Gracious God, as we turn to your word for us, may your spirit rest upon us. Help us to be steadfast in our hearing, in our speaking, in our believing, and in our living. Amen.
How many of you remember, or remember is probably not the right word because he's still living. How many of you know Lou Holtz? Lou Holtz was the coach of the Notre Dame University football team for a number of years back in the 80s and 90s. Not only is he a football coach, he's a really just a good man. I also want to share that he spent a little bit of time in North Carolina as well. He was a coach at North Carolina State, and I believe his last stint was at the University of South Carolina, for all you Gamecock fans out there. After the Cotton Bowl was played one year, reporters gathered up around him. They were clicking his photograph, and all of them were trying to ask questions and get his response. They were saying to him, what a difference maker this game is, how impactful this game had been on the entire sport. And Coach Holtz responded. He said, wait a minute, the game isn't all that important. There must have been at least 3 billion people in China who don't even care about it. Friends, this was a mountaintop experience. And sooner or later, we have to leave behind those mountaintop experiences. And we must return to the valley down below, down there where there are dangerous days for life and for faith. Mountaintop experiences are powerful experiences in our life. They're engaging. They're often chock full of ways to grow. They're chock full of clarity and often full of rest. We heard about a mountaintop experience last Sunday. Pastor Van shared with us about the experience of Jesus, who was up on a mountaintop, talking to Elijah and Moses, two of our fathers of the faith. Now, the strange thing was, as he was talking to the two of them have been dead for over a millennium now. And so, it's strange. The disciples, Peter, James, and John, are curious and bewildered. And as they're speaking, Christ is literally shining this bright light in this interaction. And Peter, James, and John are all here to witness this bigger than a bucket list event. As all of this is going on, Peter says to Jesus, Lord, wouldn't it be a good idea for us to build three dwelling places, one for you, one for Elijah, and one for Moses? The Bible tells us he didn't know what he was saying. And then, almost out of nowhere, as Peter is just getting these words out of his mouth, there's a cloud that envelops over him. And a voice comes from this cloud, and it says, this is my son, my beloved. With him I'm well pleased. Listen to him. This cloud coming down on them with this ominous voice must have been terrifying to the disciples. Peter obviously hasn't been paying attention to what's been happening. Perhaps God was telling Peter through this cloud and this message, Peter, shut your mouth, please, because God's polite all the time. No, he was telling Peter, bless his heart. That's what he was trying to say. Peter was with the other two disciples, confused by this interaction and what it really meant. He's talking about building some kind of shrine, remember? A monument to the moment instead of a testament to the heart. This is followed by Jesus telling the disciples to hop up, let's go. We've got business to do, let's go down the mountain. And that brings us to today's gospel that Susan just shared a few minutes ago, which is certainly not a mountaintop experience, our gospel lesson today. It does, however, invite us to peer in and investigate a bit on temptation, sin, right and wrong, as we travel down into the valley. On this first Sunday in Lent, we are in a season that lasts for 40 days. This period of time is based on the 40 days that Jesus spent in the desert, in the wilderness, being tempted, fasting. It's a serious time for us, a time to contemplate, a time to pray, to listen for God's voice, to fast, to repent, and hopefully to grow. 40 days. It's a long time to go without food, isn't it? I'm looking at you boys in the front. I don't think they could go 40 minutes without food. This is a tough hour, isn't it, guys? Fortunately, Jesus, when he was there, was full of the Holy Spirit during this time. We joined Jesus on the trip from the hilltop to the valley, this desert, this dark, desolate field that could be compared to the valley of the shadow of death. Christ is being stalked by Satan, even as he is led by the Spirit through this wilderness journey. He's forced to endure the hot of the day and the cold of the night. Hunger, thirst, solitude, wild animals, and the threat of being in the wrong place at the wrong time in this very unforgiving environment. And remember that the Spirit that led Jesus to this desert place is the same Spirit that he had just witnessed descending upon him like a dove just a few chapters earlier in the Bible. The same Spirit that descended upon him after his baptism has now led him out into the wilderness to face temptation. Temptation that could only be imagined in some of our worst nightmares. He's been declared the Son of God. His deity has been proven. And it's being declared Son of God even by the devil who tempts him when he tries to get him to eat when he's hungry, and when he's feeling powerless, offering him the power of the world. All this while Christ is trying to rule through love, humility, and grace. When Jesus is led into the wilderness by the Spirit, he's not necessarily left there alone either. I think the Spirit's in the midst of Jesus throughout this temptation. How could the Spirit not be? God, not Satan, is initiating this encounter. It was God who led Jesus to where the next mission was, not Satan. Sometimes the calling in life for all of us is more difficult than in other times. Sometimes we're challenged with working and developing our own faith, our own rhythm in our religion, before we can do the good work of helping others to discover and pursue their own. The wilderness is not only a physical place, but it's a spiritual place, a place where someone's tempted, a place where your world can be turned upside down while you try to navigate through it all. We've all visited the wilderness in our spiritual lives, haven't we? The desert often finds itself in the way of our faith. Importantly, though, it's what we do through that wilderness period, through that desert time, and how we find ourselves forming on the other side that's so important. How do we fare, friends, when tempted not to follow the way, when we think we know a better path? Have any of you ever been there where you think, I got it. I don't need any help. I've got all this on my own. I can control it. I know what the outcome's going to be. I see some head nod. We've been there. If we're in this walk, if we're taking the Christian walk seriously, we've been there. In his book, The Road to Character, David Brooks tells the story of Augustine, the 4th century theologian. Augustine, at one point in his life, deeply desired fame and status, but eventually found none of these things truly made him happy. Nothing he was accomplishing as a philosopher was giving him the contentment that he desired in life. He wrote this, "Left to ourselves, we often desire the wrong things, whether it's around the dessert tray or in the late night bar We know we should choose one thing, but end up choosing another. We understand our long-term interest in pursuing short-term pleasures. Even good things such as friendship will leave us unsatisfied if the friendship isn't rooted and attached to something higher. In the end, Augustine turned to God and said, "Our heart is restless until it finds rest in Thee." Nothing in this world will give us the rest and the peace that only God can give. And this is why Jesus says no to authority over all the kingdoms of the world, and yes to bowing down, serving, and worshiping God alone. After all of these temptations, the devil departs. Jesus comes through this game of thrones of sorts by letting go of some things and finding some others. In the end, he finds much more than he loses. May it be so for us. We can find real nourishment in the Word of God. Nourishment that is lasting. In his teachings that show us a path to a deep and lasting satisfaction. And we can find rest by worshiping God alone. And we can find safety and security in a right relationship with God. One that is rooted in love, in grace, in openness, in serving. As always, Jesus shows us the things that are worth finding and the things we should be willing to lose. Amen. Let us pray. God of deliverance and freedom, you told the people of Israel to acknowledge that all things come from your bountiful hand. Deepen our faith so that we may resist temptation and in the midst of trial proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord now. Friends, I invite you to stand as we gather together to sing hymn number 357, "Just As I Am Without One."
Thank you.
Amen. If you'll find your Lenten affirmation in your bulletin, we will say together what we believe. We believe in God the Creator, who made us and all things, who set us on our path in this world. We believe in God the Savior, who is one with the Creator, who rescued us and all creation from the depredations of our violations against God and creation. This man, Jesus of Nazareth, the Christ, walked a path through this world, taking on human form, having been born of a woman through the power of the Holy Spirit. He lived and worked in this world among people just like us. He walked God's path to death on a cross and rose from the dead to open our pathway to eternal life. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, our counselor and guide, who is one with the Creator and the Christ, who through the body and blood of Jesus brings us into communion with all people, past, present, and future, who calls us to walk a sacred way of life through this world, caring for creation and the people we meet on the way, loving them, helping them, welcoming them without prejudice, being God's hands and feet in the world. Amen. You may be seated. Let us begin our time of sharing with our joys and thanksgivings. For what are we grateful on this beautiful day? Yes. Amazing, wonderful. That is truly a trifecta. Congratulations. Other joys and thanksgivings today? Any others? Raise your hand high so I can see. Yes. Let's look at our concerns now, and they are many. Please pray for Cindy Scott and the family of Scotty Scott, who we laid to rest this past Friday. Continue to pray for Georgie Jackson's family. Her memorial service will be this coming Friday. And George Henson, whose memorial service will be coming up Saturday. Katie Sykes' grandfather passed away, so we want to lift up Katie and her family. Also, Paul's mother, Jeanette, was very sick this morning with a high fever, so we want to lift up Jeanette and just everyone in that family. Please continue to pray for the Bullock family, remembering that Dora just lost her father, and then last week, Danny lost his grandmother, Betty Churchwell. So lift up the Bullocks as well. We continue to pray for Rich Meyer, who is in rehab in Pollocksville, for Betty Evans, who is in rehab in Havelock. We pray and give thanks for Gene Horrell and Paula Lasker, both of whom had surgery last week and are home recovering. Continue to pray for the people in Turkey and Syria. If you follow the news, you saw they had another earthquake last week, and now the death toll is over 50,000. And continue to pray for the people of Ukraine and Russia, where I am sure the death toll in 1 year of savage fighting is probably well above 50,000 with no end in sight. We also lift up our Costa Rica trip for our youth and their chaperones. We've hit some stumbling blocks, difficulty getting airfare. Airfare has doubled for those flights and a lot of other things. So we pray that those obstacles would be removed, and we pray that God would resource that wonderful opportunity for us and our young people. Are there others this morning that you would like to lift up? Yes. Prayers for the family of Sarah Harding. We will pray. We will lift your family up. Yes.
Chris Wagner had open heart surgery on Thursday.
Chris Wagner, open heart surgery coming up this week. Thank you. Any others today? Yes. June Packard having complications from what should have been a routine surgery. We'll lift up June as well. Any others? Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, as we begin this 2023 Lenten journey, we remember that you set your face towards Jerusalem and walked alongside all those who suffer. Be our vision that we too may walk the way of the cross and extend a hand of help to those we meet. Lord, give us the gladness of your help and support us with a willing spirit. Lord, you stop to heal the sick and cure the lame and give sight to the blind. Be our vision that we too may stop and give freely of our time to others and respond to their needs. Lord, you said the first shall be last and the last first. Be our vision that we too may work towards your kingdom, where the exalted will be brought low and the lowly exalted. Lord, you ate with tax collectors and sinners of every kind and heard their stories. You excluded no one. Be our vision that we too may listen to all, to the despised, the rejected, to everyone and value their lives. Lord, you took time to pray and time to be silent. Keep us mindful of that throughout Lent, so that through our own prayers and fasting and giving, we too may draw closer to you and find your way. And Lord, you enter Jerusalem with peace in your heart. You are the Prince of Peace. Be our vision that we too may seek peace where others seek war, and that we may work for justice where injustice reigns. Lord, give us the gladness of your help and support us with a willing spirit. Almighty God, we lift up our scouting program and 94 years of faithful service and participation here at Centenary United Methodist Church. We thank you for all of those who have led our scouts. We thank you for all who have been scouts. We thank you for all the Eagles and all the family members that have been a part of this wonderful scouting program. We pray that they would be blessed, and we pray that you would continue to bless our church and bless our community with these young leaders. God, we also give you thanks for 3 days of revival last week, days in which the Holy Spirit invaded our sanctuary once again in a powerful way and reached out and touched hearts through preaching and praying and music and fellowship. And God, we lift up those concerns that we named aloud, particularly those who are asking for prayers for loved ones, for those who are recovering from surgery with complications, for those who are facing surgery, for those who are now grieving the loss of someone that meant so much to them, and so many other reasons, God, some of which only you know. We pray that you would help us to find peace and meaning and comfort in whatever happens to us, for you are our hope and our salvation. We offer these in all our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who taught his disciples to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our ushers are prepared to receive our offering, and I would like to offer this prayer first. Let us pray. God of the wilderness, God of the dry and lonely places, we give our offering in gratitude, rejoicing in the abundance of your gifts to us, no matter where we are. We give our offerings in faith, trusting that you will provide for our needs. We give our offerings in hope, knowing that you can use our gifts to spread your love in this world. And with these offerings, we give ourselves too. May we all live with generous hearts and with open hands. Amen.
Thank you.
Christ to those that are around.
The Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Our closing hymn is on page 292. What wondrous love is this? Share the benediction with you this morning that is the traditional benediction of United Methodist Youth. I invite you, if you know this, to join in with me. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Thank you for joining us in worship today at Centenary United Methodist Church. If you'd like to know more about Centenary, go to www.centenarychurch.com. If you'd like to speak to me or another staff member, you can reach us at 252-637-4181. Or if you'd like to visit us, come to 309 New Street in beautiful New Bern, North Carolina. God bless you, and remember, God loves you. Thank you for joining us in worship.